Yes, hi students. So in the previous class we were discussing the pests of mice. So we started with the discussion on the boar pests of mice. Okay. So this part we completed in the previous lecture. So in this class we will be concentrating on the defoliator pests. Okay. Foliage feeding insects. So in fact, if you consider the defoliator pests of mice, two pests are very serious. So in this class, I will be concentrating on those two pests. One is very serious, which occurs occasionally, but now in the outbreak years, it becomes very problematic. Is oriental armyworm. Okay, so we are all well aware of the term armyworm. Okay, in fact, there are a number of armyworm species which occurs in very serious manner throughout the world, and in this class we will be discussing those two armyworms, okay, which are very serious on mice. The oriental armyworm, the scientific name of this oriental armyworm is Mytilma subarachnoides. Okay, so it actually belongs to family Naturidae. So why it's called oriental armyworm is that it is distributed in the oriental region. So oriental region means it includes India, China, okay, Southeast Asian countries, okay, like Malaysia and other countries. So there it becomes very problematic. The second defoliator pest, okay, which we are concentrating in this class is fall armyworm. Okay, which is recently invaded pest. So the scientific name of this insect is Spodoptera pulchimbala. Okay, so both of them belongs to family, not to the Aphelipteryx. Okay, so we will take one by one. So we will start with the oriental armyworm, Mytilma subarachnoides. Okay, as I was mentioning, it is distributed in the oriental region. That's why it's called oriental armyworm. Okay, so how to know what actually the damage it causes? So we will start with the nature of damage. So as we know, the larva is the feeding stage, which actually attacks our crop. In the larval stage, it actually acts as defoliator. So defoliator means, so we have seen now, so partly the leaf is now eaten away like that. But this insect, in fact, now removes the entire foliage within only the midrib. Okay. So and as a result of that, now the maize plant actually now consists, will remain with only the stem and with midribs only. So all other foliage part is completely eaten away, leaving only the stem and the midrib, and thus causing heavy defoliation in case of mice. That's how it becomes very problematic. Okay, so that means we'll find the defoliation. That is the damage symptom in mice. Okay, so that means how actually it becomes very problematic. I was telling that now in the outbreak years. What do you mean by outbreak years? Okay, that means, is it not there? No, very major pest or occasional pest like that. So in fact, in the years of outbreak, this becomes very problematic. So how actually outbreak occurs? What are the reasons for increasing the population and thus causing damage? So in fact, it does not occur in the every years. Okay, so usually the damage occurs after 5 to 6 years of drought and heavy rainfall years. So in that heavy rainfall year, it becomes very problematic, and that's okay, considered as outbreak year. Say for example, what happened in the 2017 in India? So for example, for about 4 or 5 years previously, so since from 2012 or 13, not much rainfall. There was no much rainfall in India. But in the year of 2017, there was a huge rainfall, heavy rainfall, and thus okay, become congenial. Become a trigger for the increased incidence of this insect. Okay, so there was an enormous population, especially in southern states, especially in Karnataka. There was a very serious outbreak of this Mytilma subarachnoides, and thus causing heavy loss in case of mice. Okay, so the important trigger is the serious drought for long years and heavy rainfall leads to increased incidence of this insect. So that is the trigger, in fact. So that means, if you take the data of about more than 100 years or 50 years, So once in 10 years or once in 12 years, I'm telling it is not in a cycle, in a cyclical manner, but whenever you find the long drought years followed by heavy rainfall year, that heavy rainfall year actually notice heavy incidence of Vaidhyamana Sankheta. Okay, so the reason being, so drought followed by the heavy rainfall. So that actually answers Pringham. So coming to identification feature on the biology of the sunset. Okay, so usually adults lay sticks on the undersurface of the, say for example, is a maize plant. You will notice the eggs on the undersurface of the leaves. Usually, a moth can lay up to 2000 to 3000 eggs. You see what happens. Such a high fecundity is there. It hatch in 6 to 7 days. Okay. And how actually larval works? Okay. Because I am talking about two armworms in this class. One is oriental armworm and another is a pall armworm. How do you identify this? So larva is in fact translucent, very fleshy, and this can be recognized with two yellowish stripes, in fact, and there will be an intermediate in the middle region. There will be a white patch, a white line will be present. If I read the dorsal region, you will be able to understand it better. Okay, so the medial region will find a white line like this. And there are two medial lines like this. Okay, which are usually yellowish color, and this is the usual light color. Along with that, in the lateral region, you will find a brownish or dark brown line just above the spherical line. So, these are the spherical, for example, you will find a dark patch in the lateral region. So, thereby, with these yellowish lines, yellowish lateral lines followed by an intermediate line which is actually light colored, and then a dark grey colored lateral line, okay, just above the spherical surface. Okay, thereby you can identify this insect. Okay, otherwise you will not find much of those spots and all which we actually find in case of those productive and fruitive part. Okay, thereby you can identify. And pupation occurs in soil. Okay, so probably the occupation may occur deep in the soil. That's why probably it requires heavy rainfall, and that actually may act as a trigger for heavy population. Okay. So coming to other identification features of this oriental armworm. So comparatively well-built moth, in fact. Okay, and forelimbs are light brown colored with yellowish tinge, in fact, and there will be a round spot, so you usually call it as an orbicular spot, and there will be a reniform spot, and both of them are actually comparatively yellowish color without any edge like this, without any blackish edge. Just I am trying to show that there will be yellowish spots like this. One is called orbicular spot, one is called reniform spot. So these two spots are very clear. Okay, and there will be eye beam which is comparatively cream color, but there will be a blackish border in the outer margin. You find like this. Okay, so otherwise, you will find this yellowish tinge, brown color, but there will be yellowish tinge, but there will be very clear these orbicular spot and reniform spot. So, and there is a blackish border in place of mind. So, thereby you can identify this insect. Okay, so what are the management strategies for this insect? Very important management strategies, but people try to develop the management strategies for this insect, but because of non-availability of insect. If I say non-availability means it occurs once in 10 years or 12 years. Okay, so it's very difficult to research on such insects. Okay, so one very important practice which is widely adopted for the management of this insect during the outbreak years is poison breeding. Very important strategy in fact. Although egg collection, deflowing, ant collection of larvae is also practiced. Very important practice which is widely adopted, because once the maize grows after 50 days or 60 days, it is very difficult to go for spraying. Okay, and even for performing any of those such operations. So under that condition, during the outbreak, yes, the best management strategy which is adopted is poison baiting. How actually can go for poison baiting? So we require, in fact, per acre 10 kg of rice or wheat bran. Okay, for this we need about 2 to 3 kg of gathering. Okay. And about 150 ml of monocrotophos. Okay, so these are the materials which are required. And along with, you need to require about 2 to 3 liters of water. Okay, so what needs to be done in here is that, so 10 kg of wheat bran or rice bran has to be taken and mixed with 2 to 3 kg of jaggery with sufficient amount of water. Okay, so that needs to be kept for about 24 hours or so, so that the material actually gets fermented. So you get a lot of bad smell. And during hours, usually this, the larvae are actually active during the evening hours. Okay, during that time, during evening hours, after 24 hours of preservation of this material for fermentation, so monocrotophos has to be mixed with this material, okay, properly, and that has to be broadcasted in the field. Okay, so this poison light has to be broadcasted in the rice field so that the larvae, which are active during night time, they come and feed on this poison light and they get there. Okay, so one of the very important practice which is adopted for management of oriental armyworm. Okay, so that's about the oriental armyworm. So now we take up another armyworm which was introduced recently and become widespread and causing very serious loss throughout India and now spread to other countries as well is the fall armyworm. Okay, Spodoptera fusiparta. So we have a close relative to Spodoptera litora and other species which is considered as a cutworm, but this acts as an armyworm. Okay, Spodoptera fusiparta. So distribution, as I told, basically this is an American pest. Okay, especially in South America, Florida and other countries. So there is a native pest in fact for America. But in the year 2016, it was first time reported in Africa, other than the Americas. Okay, so then in the year 2018, it was reported from India. And especially, it was reported for the first time from Sri Lanka by Sarnabasappa and Kaleshwar Swami in the year 2018. So it was reported from Sri Lanka in the year 2018. By now, okay, by 2020, so now it is widespread throughout India, China, Southeast Asian countries, and very recently it was reported even from Australia. So now you can imagine its movement from America to Africa to India to most of the Southeast Asian countries and another continent, Australia. That's how it is spreading, very serious pest. Okay, so I say very serious, what actually it is doing? Okay, what is the nature of damage? Okay, so again, as it is a defoliator pest, it is defoliating. How it's actually defoliating? What are the symptoms you notice? Okay, so again, if you see the rice plant, in fact, if we see the, usually it remains in the deep puddles. Larvae will remain in the puddles and it comes out and feeds on the leaves, making elongated rows like this. And initially, if you see the early vistas, you find these whitish lines like this. These are actually scraped things. When the chlorophyll material is actually scraped, so you find this type of whitish patches on the leaf. Okay, so, but the later vista actually causes this type of elongated rows and larvae looks like torn off. Okay. So we find those usually because of feeding damage, the growth of the plant gets affected. And a very important symptom which notice in the oral is that we find lot of accumulated fecal matter. So excreta get accumulated in this region. So therefore you can easily recognize the incidence of this insect. Okay. So unlike armyworm, the oriental armyworm, which actually completely eats away the entire plant, meaning only the stem and the midrib, this one won't do like that much. Okay, it actually causes this type of whitish patches as well as elongated rows like this under leaves may be eaten away here and there. Okay, remaining in the bones. So these are the important symptoms noticed because of the larval feeding. Okay, so now we'll see the identification features are the biology of fall armyworm. Okay, so similar to the oriental armyworm, usually the eggs are laid on the upper surface of leaves. So usually you find the 50 to 800 number of eggs by single female. But you know, there are instances that it can lay up to 300 eggs. Okay, so it hatches in 2 to 3 days. That means the incubation period is about 2 to 3 days. And the larva, so larva can be identified with the help of some dark spots or tubercles which are found on the, especially on the 8th and 9th abdomen segment. On the 8th as well, you find this inverted V-shaped structure. It is very clear. So although it is found in various other spots of the group, so that is not an important diagnostic feature, but if I write the dorsal diagram, we will be able to understand this. Say for example, this is the 8th segment and this is the 9th segment. So on the 8th segment, you will find the 4 spots, tubercles, which are arranged in spiral form like this. Okay, so this is the 8th segment. Okay, in case of 9th segment, those 4 spots are arranged in trapezoidal manner like this. So this is the 9th segment. Okay, thereby can easily recognize. The larval color actually varies from location to location and all those things. But, so these spots are very clear. Okay, so thereby you can identify this. So and again, pupation occurs in a, in a soil. So we rarely was known to pupate even in the stem or in the carp itself. So I think I forgot to tell that the incidence actually very serious up to about 45 to 50 days. Okay, afterwards the incidence actually get reduced. But also rarely under Indian condition it also known to attack calves. But you know, not much incidence, less than 1% incidence has been reported on the calves as well. So pupation occurs in the stem as well as calf to very rare manner. Otherwise, the pupation occurs inside. Okay. So then how do you recognize the heart attack? So in fact, there is a sexual dimorphism. The males and females look different. So that's called sexual dimorphism. So actually, we find the males, for example. Let me start with the males. Okay. So the males, the foreheads are grey colored, greyish brown you can say. And there will be a whitish triangular patch like this is found in the apical region. So this is the apical region of the forehead, you find this whitish part. And there will be a orbicular spot which is comparatively V-shaped. Not like very clear, but there will be an orbicular spot which is V-shaped. You can see it like this. And there will be a reniform spot which is comparatively oval. Okay. So through these three important characteristic features, we can identify this male. So whereas usually the eyebrows are silvery white color. Okay, so there will be whitish triangular patch in the apical region, and there will be an orbicular spot, which is V-shaped, and there will be a reniform white spot which is found. It's almost not exactly round, it's a comparatively oval shape. With these three structures, we can easily identify the male Spodoptera fujiparda. Whereas the female will not find much variation, any of those spots and all, but which is more or less uniformly grey color. The corvids are grey color. Whereas white wings are like males, it's also silvery white color. So, thereby you can distinguish the males and females of Spodoptera fujiparda. So, based on biology, what are the management strategies we can come out? So we have a ad hoc recommendation because not much research has been done because it was introduced very recently in 2018. With 2 years of experience, we have an ad hoc recommendation for management of this insect. Okay, so what and all can be done? So IPM strategies has to be evolved for managing this insect. So, what are the management strategies? For example, like I was telling, it's laid on the undersurface of leaves, but we will also find on the upper surface of leaves. So, eggs can be squashed if you move out in the field. So, especially the incidence starts from the first week itself, from 10th day, you can say, to 45, 50 days. So, if you move around in the field, you notice a large number of eggs. Okay, so those eggs has to be destroyed by squashing. So, you can eliminate a large number of eggs if you go for egg removal or egg squashing. Very important strategy. Okay, so of course, pupation occurs in the soil, you can have to go for deep flowing, that has to be done pre season before going for sowing. So, money flowing is another important practice. In fact, this insect not been found to be very receptive to light trap. But so you have a pheromone traps which are commercially available already, which has to be set at the rate of 4 per acre. Okay, so pheromone traps are available, it has to be set. So very important mechanical control strategy. Coming to biological control strategies, so even though it was introduced recently, the number of native parasites have been reported to be already parasitizing and predating this insect. So important native parasites which are already on the eggs are Trichogramma sp. There are number of Trichogramma species in that. Okay, so one Tillamomma species belongs to family Retigastridae, which is a very good egg parasitoids, already showing very promising result. So these two can be used as egg parasitoids. So these can be grazed at the rate of 50,000 per hectare from first week or say 10th day onwards at 15 days intervals. So these actually parasitize the eggs, and there are various predators also have been reported. So they may be earwigs, they may be coccinellids, which are already carabids, for example, which are very common in the maize ecosystem, it's predating on the fall armyworm. But one important natural, as we are discussing biological control, one important endopathogenic fungus which is giving very promising result is Pneumonia, which is now called Metarhizobacterium. So especially in the kharif season, especially in the rainfall season, this is considered to be very useful promising biocontrol agent. So Pneumonia blei, so working well, it has to be, if it is commercially available, it has to be released and sprayed at the rate of 2 grams per liter. Okay, so these are the biological control strategy which has to be adopted. So now at last we have to adopt to chemical control strategies. So of course, so lot of research is being done in various places of India, various research stations and universities. So we have a list of chemicals which can be used for managing the Spodoptera punicola, and some of the insecticides which are found to be very effective are the lambda cyhalothrin, at the rate of 0.5 ml per liter of water, spinetoram at the rate of 0.8 ml per liter of water. And similarly, chlorantraniliprole. Okay, this has to be applied at the rate of 0.4 ml. Okay, so recently, in fact, Department of Agriculture Cooperation and the Farmers Welfare also came out with a one seed treatment chemical. Which is now commercially available. This is actually also performing well, which is commercially available as Fortenza Duo. Okay, so at the rate of 6 ml per kg, so seeds has to be treated, and it is actually giving protection up to 15 to 20 days. So if you adopt all these management strategies, self-help strategies, so we can manage the Spodoptera fujiparda. Okay, so thank you very much. So if there are any doubts, you can post below or you can email me as well. Thank you very much.